did their wedding years ago. Like 10, 11 years ago.
This is the day the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
And as always, we have so much to rejoice and to be glad in that we have a place that we can come out of the cold and stay warm inside, as well as to be able to fellowship and be together in the presence of God. So glad to have everyone here with us. Glad to have our members as well as visitors. Glad to have our people who are watching on Facebook Live. Welcome to worship as well as those who are watching the recordings on our YouTube channel as well as on Epworth Channel 6. And as always, thank you to Epworth for broadcasting our service for us. And I invite everyone to fill out the pew pads that we have here in the sanctuary so we have a record of your visit. But those of you online, if you can leave a comment so that we know you're here as well. Also, back in the summer, this has been hanging around the office. Someone lost a necklace. So it's a pretty necklace, but you can tell the clasps are missing on both ends, which means it had fallen off somehow. But if it's yours, it's got a series of little, looks like knots or beads on it. I'm going to leave it up here. If it's yours, you'll be sure to go ahead and take it. So got to get a home for it. Other than that, I know we have a few announcements that we need to make, and so I'm going to turn it over to Carolyn, who's just ready to go, aren't you, Carolyn?
Yes.
Yes.
Good morning, disciples.
Good morning.
Today, if you have not seen the post on Facebook, is World Kindness Day.
Oh, yay.
And the purpose is to look beyond ourselves, beyond the boundaries of our country, beyond our culture, our race, our religion, and realize that we are citizens of the world and that kindness is a common thread that unites us all. So let's be extra kind today. Right after church will be a board meeting in the chapel. Next Sunday will be congregational meeting right after church. Monday at 4:30, the handbell will practice. Our regular activities are on Wednesday. It's our day for the soup kitchen. If you find time that you have time, call Judy. And Judy will be glad to put you to work on Wednesday. And November 23rd, which is Wednesday, from 10 to noon, you're invited to come deck the, not the halls, but the sanctuary. So everyone show up and help make quick work of that. Does anyone have any other announcements? Then let's greet each other in fellowship.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Let's remain standing and turn in our hymnbooks to page 561. It is well with my soul, and there will be singing all creatures. Or you can look up on the screen.
Thank you.
Will you join with me in the call to worship? God is ready to answer us even before we call. God is eager to listen, though we are not ready to speak.
Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well.
If the seas join in praise, how much more should we? If hills are alive with song, let us too awake to sing.
Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well.
Will you join with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, Creator of all, we thank you for the blessings of this week. We thank you for sunshine, for rain, and for snow. We thank you for the opportunity to join here today on World Kindness Day, and help us to be kind to all we meet every day. Be with us as we listen, open our eyes, our hearts, and our ears to your message. Be with us as we go from here. Help us to spread your light and your love to all we meet. This we ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen. And as you're being seated, I invite any children, if we have any children that want to come forward. Becky Kruger has said that she would love to do a children's moment. And Becky, behind you, get the microphone there. So, yeah, all kids that are here, if you all want to come up, meet Becky down here. Operation Christmas time.
Going on in their life.
that made them be a little bit mean at that moment. And you can be thankful that that's not how you are, because our response to somebody that's mean to us is your responsibility. Holy cow, these kids are smart guys. So we can be thankful that God helps us respond to a situation like that. How about at home, if your mom or dad or somebody says, I thought I told you to clean that room up. I thought, and they get really upset with you and they're disappointed with you. Can you be thankful about that?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Oh, that is so good. That isn't even the direction I was going, but you're exactly right. You can be thankful that they care about you, that they care about how you take care of things. That's so good. Have you ever made Rice Krispie snacks?
No.
No? Oh, man, you guys can take care of that and have her make some. You put all the Rice Krispies in a bowl, right? And they're just all loose in there. I like to think of that as lots of different bits of kindness that you can experience every day, no matter where you are. All those Rice Krispies are different little pieces of kindness and thankfulness. Because really, Carolyn, thankfulness and kindness kind of go hand in hand. So I'm glad you pointed that out, that today is National Kindness Day. But until we pour in what? Does it stick together? Marshmallows, and stir it all together. And then it all starts sticking together. I like to think of that as God's love pouring into the kindness that, and the thankfulness that we have, and making it all stick together to form our hearts and how we respond to situations. And you guys are so smart about how we do that. Thank you for being here today. We're going to say a little prayer, and I actually have a Rice Krispie snack for you. Dear God, we thank you so much for each one of these children. We thank you that their lives are a true example of what kindness should be. And when they encounter times when it is hard to be kind, thank you for giving us Jesus to lend us a hand and to be the example you would want us to be. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. I invite you now to find in your bulletins the insert that's labeled as announcements, because right underneath that is where we list our concerns. And as every week, I encourage you all to take that home so you can see who all we're praying for, and you can pray for them on a daily basis. Lift up those that are battling cancer and ongoing medical concerns, but bring your attention down to the immediate. Got a report this morning. Carolyn had shared with me that Bud Andreas is doing well. They got his medications balanced out, and hopefully he gets to go home tomorrow. So that'd be good. And hopefully they got all the cancer removed. We're still praying for Perry and Gary Drake. That's Sarah's grandson and husband. We're still praying for. We're praying for you too, as you try to keep everybody together. That's a good thing too.
I'll add one more. My son is having shoulder surgery this coming Thursday.
Oh, oh.
In Texas, and I can't be there, so I'm not happy.
Her son's having shoulder surgery. I have to do that one slow.
It should be just a one day, and you know.
It's outpatient. Yeah, that's what Darla just had too. And it's in Texas, so she can't be there for her son. I understand how that can be hard. Mox, we're still praying for you, and glad that you're here today, Mox. And hopefully
figure out what's going on with your hip there. Kay Cordell, did she finally have her surgery and she's doing okay? Good. Many people have asked about Darla and her shoulder surgery. She's doing okay. Her pain level's at a 5 now, so that's good. And she's only taking the pain pills before her physical therapy. So we're to that point. She wished she could be here this morning, but couldn't quite be here. She's maybe watching at home. Hey, babe. So Cora is back in the at Cottonwood Manor. Is that Cottonwood? Cottonwood Creek. Cottonwood Creek. They keep changing names. It's hard to keep straight with everybody. But Cora's back there. Used to be Grace Living Center. Katie Went, I talked to Philip yesterday and said that her surgery did go well and she's still in her recovery. They had repaired her torn meniscus. So, and Becky, we have you on the list.
Take
her off the list. Yay. Her shoulder is still hurt, though. But there you go. Your rotator cuff, okay. But then Tracy, we're still praying for you, who did have carpal tunnel and more done. Hey, you got a new cast.
A formal cast.
It's elegant black. Yes. So.
Goes with everything.
And Mark, we're praying for you and your pain, and you said you're doing okay. And also to head down Carrie Wilkerson, but I didn't write down who brought that up last week. Oh, it was you, Dwayne, yeah. And how's Carrie doing? He passed away. Oh. I'm going to make a note of that. Okay. Thank you for that, Dwayne. Okay. Are there any other...
For you to keep Jensen.
Yeah. So he celebrated his third birthday by being sick. But we're glad he made 3.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
That's a miracle.
That's a miracle that he made it to 3.
He can throw a football. He can do anything.
Yeah.
He has left a right hand to eat, so he's amazing.
Okay. Any others? If not, then let us center ourselves as we go before our Lord in this time of prayer. We feel your presence, O God, as we have gathered here in your house of worship or at home watching online or watching the recordings of the service. We feel that you are a part of our lives, and for that we do pause to give you thanks that you are everlasting and that you will never let us down. You will never fail us. We find comfort in that. We find comfort in knowing that when we have times of struggle, when we know people that are going through surgeries and recovering and illnesses and loss of loved ones, that we have a church family to lean back on. We have friends and family members. We have you and your arms to fall into to find the strength when ours is not enough. Hear our prayers as we lift them up to you, God, of our friends and family members, even people we've never met. Hear our prayers. As they struggle in the darkness, may your light shine. But God, we also know that life has its joys and too, and celebrations and things we can laugh about and dance and sing. Help us, God, to never forget to look at those moments. For that, we pause to give you thanks as well, that you celebrate with us. For God, we know that in the ups and in the downs, you're always with us, that you will never wither away and die, that you will endure forever by our side. And for that, we do give you thanks. For these we lift up to you in the name of the one who came to show us how to love one another and called us to be in that love. In Jesus' name, we pray. I invite our deacons to make their way to the back of the sanctuary as we prepare to receive our offering this morning. You will find in your bulletins an insert, a nice colored insert with a little envelope with it, for it's time for us to give to one of our special offerings. And it's the Sunday we get to focus on higher education and the support that the higher education gives. That's why I'm wearing my master's hood. I only wear it usually once a year to focus on the fact that higher education is so important, that if anybody would like to go and to pursue more education, that's important for us to do. Many of the seminary students, by the time you get through your undergraduate and you've paid all that tuition for college, and then you're like, but God's calling me to go into ministry, you're still paying on all this college fee. Many of our seminaries have wonderful scholarships. Phillips Theological Seminary, where I went to get my master's degree, offers a scholarship up to 80% of the tuition to anybody who, I mean, that is amazing that they can offer that to every student. But that's only possible because of special offerings like this that is gathered in this church and many others being united together. But I also want to share with you something that Philip Wendt said last night when we were at the Altrusa Hall of Trees, the big fundraiser that Altrusa does once a year, where they decorate the trees and they auction them off. And Paul Lewis does a great job, does he not? I mean, just amazing. And Philip Wendt made a comment. He said, wow. He goes, whenever we have a community event like this one, or the Historical Society had a community event, or some of the other stuff that's been going on downtown, he said, you know what? First Christian Church may not be the biggest church, but we have the biggest percentage of church members who turn out to support the community. And I said, you know what, Philip, you're absolutely right. So it's with great pride that we say that First Christian Church is a very active part of the community of Chickasha. And it'd be great to say the same on the general level as well as the regional level. We do a great job of supporting those that are around us. Think of these things and others as the plates are passed. Indeed, God, we pause to give thanks this morning, for you have blessed us in ways that we can never begin to imagine and measure. But out of that blessing, we offer back a portion. Bless our effort so that we can make a difference in this world for your glory. In Christ's name, amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
come now to the time of hearing of God's word. If you are able, please stand out of respect for the reading of the word. Today's scripture is found in Luke 20, 27 through 38, page 79 and 80, and your pew Bible are up on the screen. Here begins the reading. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, he said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." And they asked him, "Teacher, when will this be, and what will be the sign that this is about to take place?" And he said, "Beware that you are not led astray. For many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and the time is near. Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." And then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places famines and plagues, and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds. Do not prepare your defense in advance, for I will give you the words and wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed, and even by parents and brothers, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I believe it was somewhere around 1956. About 1956, when there was a group of people that had a vision that had come to fruition. All their work had come into place. They were a congregation that was growing like many of the churches were growing back in the 40s and the 50s. And they had outgrown their facility. They wanted a new facility, and they had done their research, and it all had come to place. All the people that were a part of this vision of coming up with a brand new building had finally come true. All that had caught the vision, all the people that had worked hard and had made possible for this building to be built, a building that was going to be a beacon of hope to the neighborhood that was around it. As people were going to be driving to school or to work, they would see this building, and it would be an inspiration more than any other church building that had ever been built before it. It was going to be a spire of hope and of strength and of longevity. But they're not the first that had that idea, that a building could be that for them as a place of worship. With that in mind, we can see through the eyes of the disciples as they stood there with our Lord and Savior in front of the 15-story building known as the temple. 15 stories. That was quite remarkable. In a time when you'd have to go to Rome to see something of that kind of grandeur at that time. And right here in Jerusalem was the temple. In their own neighborhood, they could see it and they could worship. And it was beautiful. A place of magnificent connection to God. Now, this temple that we're talking about today is actually the third temple. The first one was built by King Solomon in around 587 BCE. Before Common Era. When the Jews were captured by the Babylonians, one of the first things the Babylonians did was they destroyed that first temple. So later on, when they were released back into captivity, when they got back to Jerusalem, they built a new temple. But when Herod came to power, he saw that temple and thought, that's not good enough. So he tore it down in the year 20 BCE. He tore it down so he can make way for this new big grand temple. And that's the one, the third temple that Jesus and the disciples are standing in front of when our scripture takes place. And it was a breathtaking sight, this 15-story tall temple. It was immaculate. And it took 46 years to build. Can you imagine that? 46 years to build this temple. It was covered in sheets of gold so that when the sun was at the right angle, it had such a glare that said that people had a difficulty even staring in the direction of the temple. A fitting tribute to God lift high on Mount Zion. It was beautiful. A permanent symbol that would stand the test of time. Generations would come and see this is what humanity can do when they pull out all the stops. It was beautiful. But you see, our Lord and Savior, who can see into our hearts, could tell where the disciples' thoughts were going. A symbol of their love for God, a testimony of God's everlasting presence, yes. But has this building slipped ever so slightly, ever so quietly, into a place that they worshiped instead of a place they went to worship? So Jesus turns to them and tells them about being worried. That this temple, this magnificent temple, will be destroyed someday. Not even one stone will be left on top of another. I could just see them going, "What, Jesus? What are you talking about? This temple? You must be looking down the road at that shack down there, because this thing, ooh, it's going to be here forever. I mean, it's 15 stories tall, covered in gold. How in the world can this be, Jesus?" He warns them that it can happen because he's warning them about false prophets. Those who come and say that they are Jesus and that they're working in his name. But following them will end in devastation. You know, false prophets are really not so easy to see. Wouldn't it be great if false prophets had a little name badge? So then when we saw them and it said false prophet, oh, I'm not going to listen to you. But they don't work that way, do they? In 1978, when I was about 9 years old, I was out playing one summer, and all my friends were busy. They couldn't come out. And there was a new group of guys that were out there playing, and I recognized them from school. They were the cool kids from school. And they said, "Come on over and play with us." And I'm like riding my little bicycle over there. I was so excited. I was in the in crowd. I was with them. I was out there playing. Now, this is back when nobody had cell phones. Back when everybody's mother was a network to each other. And they all watched what we were doing. In the days that when the streetlights came on, that meant you went home. But the streetlights hadn't come on yet. And one of my friend's moms came out and said, "Michael, is that you?" And I said, "Yeah." "Well, your mom called and wants you to go home." And I said, "Okay." So I turned to my new friends and I said, "Sorry, guys, I got to go home." And one of them said, "Why?" And I went, "Because my mama called. I'm supposed to go home when mama calls." And they said, "You don't have to do that." Oh, my stomach all started churning up like a wash rag when you're trying to get the water out of it. I was like, "Oh, this isn't right. No, my mama said come home. I got to go home." A false prophet can be just a friend who tries to plant a bad idea. Why couldn't they be as obvious as, like, say, Westboro Baptist Church? I mean, obviously, who in the world is going to want to follow Westboro Baptist Church? I mean, their guys are out of their minds. Of course, you know, almost everybody in their congregation is related to each other. So they're all out of their minds. And so it's kind of obvious. We don't want to follow that. A false prophet. It would be so great if it was easy to spot them, but then they would lose their power if you could spot them. And yet, some false prophets can be that person who's right down the road from you, that group of new friends, or the guy who lives in the house down the street from you, or the girl at the bakery, the people you live with, you went to school with, and you're around. You see, about 40 years after Jesus had this encounter in front of the temple, 40 years later, there was a group of people right there in their neighborhood, people they went to school with, who became very zealot against the Roman Empire. They were sitting there working up all this energy and saying, you know what, I'm tired of the Roman Empire. You see, what Rome would do is they would conquer a town, and they would say, you know what, you could still be your town. You could still be Chickasha. You're just going to have to follow our rules. And then they would leave and leave a couple of guards. And that's how they conquered. And they had all these little towns. And so these zealots said, we're tired of having to live under the rules of the Roman Empire, and got a lot of people all worked up. And so they, guess what? They went and they revolted against the Roman Empire. Rome couldn't have that, because if that little town, Jerusalem, gets away with it, what about the other one? What about the one down the road? So Rome pounced on them. They came down hard on them. And the gates of Jerusalem, it kind of held up as best it could. And so they locked the gates so that Rome couldn't get in. But guess what? The food ran out eventually. And they resulted to cannibalism. And it just all kind of fell apart. And after a while, the walls even failed. And Rome got into the city. And they burned everything that could burn. And if it couldn't burn, they tore it down. The great temple, the 15-story building covered in gold, was destroyed. And guess what? Not one stone was left on top of another. Sometimes the false prophets can be the ones that are right there in our community. So this congregation in 1956 got to sit in their brand new building. Their vision came to, it was beautiful too. Could seat over 1,000, almost 2,000 people. Had a beautiful pipe organ going in. Had an elevator in it. It even had an escalator in it. Some of you all know which church I'm referring to. For the First Christian Church of Oklahoma City was the Church of Tomorrow, the Dome Church, a beacon to all who drove down the highway. They could see the giant egg that was stuck in the ground. We all knew it. It was a beacon. But as they gathered there, did they know 66 years later that a crane would come and tear that dome down? No one thought of that when they were sitting there in that very first worship. They thought, oh my gosh, this building's going to be here for generations to come. I mean, my goodness, buildings have been around for hundreds and hundreds of years. No one would have believed them if we had told them in 66 years that the building would come down. Buildings are a sign of longevity, aren't they? We build these buildings and we expect them to be there forever and forever. So we build them as an effort to have longevity. But whose longevity is it? When Herod built the temple, was it God's longevity or was it Herod's longevity? Herod wanted to leave a legacy. He wanted to leave a legacy for God, whose son was born in a lowly manger in a cave kind of by to himself. And he built this legacy of 15 stories covered in gold. Whose legacy really was that? You see, the temple that was there right before Herod built this one, I'm sure it was perfectly fine. I'm sure God said, oh yeah, it's fine. There's nothing wrong with that one. Y'all can worship there. But in their new temple, this new grand, glorious one, they felt successful. They felt safe. They felt like it was going to be there forever in eternity. Has the temple, did it slip ever so quietly and slowly into a place of a false prophet? Is it possible? We don't know how they felt as the stones came tumbling down, being attacked by rope and horse. Imagine the sick feeling they had when this temple they put so much trust would be there forever was now coming down and gone. A symbol of all of their trust had failed. Their false god had come to an end, and they were scared and they were lost. But they forgot the words of Jesus who said, don't be afraid when these things happen because God will always be there. Can you imagine? Can you imagine when we put that much trust in something and it fails us? Governments that have become corrupt and they forget the fact that the people are not there to serve the government, but the government is there to serve the people. Healthcare industry that says that we're here to heal you as long as you have enough money. School administration who spend more time trying to raise funds and not focus on the fact that we need to have good education for our children. Infrastructure that was there to make sure that we have running water, we have safe roads to drive on, power and communication grids. kids, have bridges that literally fall as people are driving over them. We have internet that keeps coming on and off again, and power that comes on and off, water that's not drinkable anymore. And we put our trust in these things, and when they fail us, we sit there and we're scared. What's it going to be like in our world if these things aren't here? And God says, it's okay, because I'm here with you. And Jesus said, beware of false prophets, those things that take your trust away from God and put it somewhere else. Be aware of those false prophets. When I was preparing for the sermon, I have to be honest with you, I got a little scared myself, because I'm thinking, well, what would happen? What happens if our economy does fall apart? We all know what happened during the Great Depression, don't we? I mean, what would happen if the rain doesn't come and the crops don't grow and we don't have any food left? We all remember the insensitivity of nature during the Dust Bowl and how relentless it is. What if there's another pandemic that comes and they can't find a vaccine for it? What if we came to worship one Sunday morning and we found the doors were bolted shut and a sign was put on by the government that said, no one can worship anymore? That's scary stuff. But Jesus' message was simple. Be aware of those who lead you away from God and God's protection, God's strength, God's love, and our trust in God. Because you know what? These times are going to happen. They're going to come either personally or on a global scale. They're going to come, he says. But don't be afraid, for I will always be with you. So was Jesus trying to scare people? Was Luke trying to scare us by recording this in his gospel? No, it's not a matter of being scared. It's a matter of fact that Jesus found a spotlight, got behind it, and swung it around to the disciples to shine on them. Hey, there's a false prophet that has snuck up on you, and I'm shining a light on it. Hey, take a look at that. There's a false prophet right there with you. Institutions like governments and nations have risen and they have fallen, and yet God has never failed us. The greatest achievements of humanity have all withered away at some point or another, but God's love never withers away. Jesus was not against the temple, but he needed to make sure that people understood that they may be focused too much on the temple, and that maybe it has slowly crept into that place where God needs to be. So what if the temple was gone? God says, okay. I mean, the dome came down, but guess what? That church is still meeting. They're just meeting in a smaller building on the same lot. If the temple's destroyed, worship still goes on because God is still there. But before Jesus got a hold of that spotlight and shined it on them, they were unaware that they had let the temple ever so quietly slip into the wrong spot. So it makes me wonder, as I was preparing for this sermon, what if Jesus was still right there behind that spotlight and decided to swing it over toward my life? Surely there's nothing that I've let slip into that place where God should be. Surely I've not let my trust go into the wrong place. Hey, Jesus, while you're still up there with that spotlight, can you kind of swing it over this way? Amen. I like to read Diana Butler Bass. She has a neat little email she sends out every week about her thoughts, and she's a great theologian. I love her work. And she was sharing a story about how she had found a leak in her bathroom. She had a two-story house in the bathroom right above the one she had started to leak. And she looked at it, and of all the things that's happened in her life and all those things, I mean, no one likes to see a leak coming from the ceiling, do you? And yet she said, you know what? It's going to be okay. Matter of fact, the cool part was her leak was right over her bathtub. So she's like, it was just dripping right into the bathtub and going out. But, you know, she still had to get it taken care of because of the ceiling is going to collapse. And she thought, you know what? We have plumbers. And what a great thought it is that whatever happens, you know, we're going to be okay. We can solve the problems. And she thought, you know, she started this practice of being thankful ahead of time. instead of being thankful behind and saying, look back at what happened and say, I'm thankful that that happened, which is great, but that's past tense. She started a practice of trying to be thankful that, hey, this has happened in the future, but I've got the resources, that there's someone out there who knows how to fix it. And they can come out and get the plumbing fixed, and the house isn't going to fall down. The world's not going to stop spinning. Everything's going to be okay because she's forwardly thinking. And I thought that's a great way to look at it. She was quoting David Destino, who was a professor, who said, thankfulness should not only be a practice of the past, but gratitude is about ensuring the benefits of what comes next. As we gather at the table of remembrance, we got to remember that our gratitude is the fact that no matter what comes our way, whether the temple is destroyed to the point there's not one stone on top of each other, or we have a leaky pipe, whatever happens, we know that it's going to be okay because God will never fail us. And for that, we give thanks. So when we break bread and drink cup together, we are mindful of the thankfulness we really have as we gather together, that God's promise is that no matter what, I will never leave your side. For all are invited to the table of remembrance.
Let's sing our communion hymn together, I Come With Joy, found on page 420 in your hymn books or on the screen.
It was when our Lord and Savior was gathered with the disciples at that first Last Supper that he took the bread from the table. He lifted it toward heaven to give thanks. But this time he took the bread and said, this is no longer ordinary bread, for this is my body that I give unto you. Eat of it in remembrance of me. In a like manner, he poured out some wine and said, this is no longer ordinary wine, for this is my life-giving blood that I pour out freely for you, so that you can understand what true forgiveness is all about. So that we can form another covenant, a covenant that's based on love. He said, drink of this in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat of the bread and we drink of the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Let us pray.
Grant us, O God, the spirit, heart, and mind to be grateful as we come in prayer to this communion table. Thank you for the food of the week. And for this opportunity, we partake in the spiritual bread in the name of Jesus. May we sense your presence, O God, in the breaking of bread and in our prayers and renewal and dedication. Guide us through the week.
As this bread and this cup is dispersed throughout this sanctuary, we are mindful, O God, that we are all at the table. And we tiptoe very timidly because we confess that we are sinners, that we fall short of your expectations of us. And yet we know as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we find forgiveness, a renewal that we might pledge ourselves to being all that you would hope that we would become. Thankful for this cup that gives us life. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, we're thankful that you have extended the table invitation to us to gather around the table of remembrance and of fellowship. We're thankful, God. We also are aware that some of our church members are physically unable to join us at the table. Bless our elders as they extend the table of fellowship and remembrance to our homebound. So that way, God, we may all break bread and drink cup together. Whether we're physically together or apart, those that are watching by virtual can all know that we are united in our effort to remember and reflect the image of love that you've given to us in the form of your Son, our Lord and Savior, who came to live among us and to show us how to live. The least we could do out of remembrance is to offer back the prayer that he taught us so long ago. So as we blend our voices together, may your ears find it pleasing as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our sins, as we forgive those who sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. What a wonderful morning of worship it has been to be together and to worship and praise God together. What has been so wonderful. Matter of fact, it's so wonderful. Let's do it again next week. And bring a friend or two if you want to. So glad to have everybody here that was with us today. Don't forget, board members, that we're going to have a board meeting in the chapel just across the hallway. We got some important things that we need to take care of at the end of the year. And then also don't forget, next Sunday will be our congregational meeting right after worship, and that one's way shorter than the board meeting. So please make plans to be there for that. Don't forget, we have handbell practice tomorrow at 4:30. There you are. I was like, where? It's at 4:30, correct? So be here for that. And also want to say a special thank you not only to Jan and Crystal, who always bring us such beautiful music. Thank you for that. I know I say it every Sunday, but I mean it every Sunday, but also someone else who shared their talent and joy, which was Becky Kruger, who saw, hey, there's children. I want to do a children's moment. She had about 5 minutes to prepare that. So good job, Becky. So thank you for doing that. Okay, and that's it. So as we sing our closing song, if you don't have a church home and you would like, Judy, don't forget the soup kitchen. Yeah, Judy's got this look on her like, don't forget, I got need help. So yes, if you want to help in any way, if it's 5 minutes or the whole 2 hours or whatever you can do, Judy will take it. So yes, thank you for that reminder. Now, as we sing our closing song, if you don't have a church home and would like to join this congregation by transfer of membership from another congregation or to make public your confession of faith for the first time, as we sing our closing song, I'll be here to receive you. And those of you online, if you ever want to become a member of the church, just send me a message. We can make that happen too. So, but we all can respond. Oh, Rita? The choir today, wasn't that just beautiful? Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Under Crystal's direction, that was, yeah, they did. Thank you for that. I kind of forget because since I'm in the choir, you know. It's like, and did y'all like that we decided the choir can just exit down for the sermon? So, because a lot of times people are kind of coming and going, we just all, that was something new we did. And I think it went well, so great. Thank you for that. So as we sing our closing song, we can all respond in one way, but that way can be that we can also respond by singing as joyfully as we can. So Crystal, I'll turn it over to you.
Let's stand and sing together soon and very soon, and you can actually find it on the screen of the
Okay, y'all stay standing, but keep your hymnals with you. Well, you didn't have your hymnals. Find your hymnals. Turn to 341 where I can put some words in your mouth. It is with great honor that we get to welcome Joe. What's your last name, Joe?
Dowing,
thank you. We get to welcome Joe here as a member of our congregation, and she is transferring her membership. So, Joe, I just have to ask you one question. Do you reaffirm your faith that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and proclaim him as your Lord and Savior? Then I extend to you the right hand of fellowship. Welcome to the First Christian Church. And they all have something they want to say to you. And it's very inspirational. They just came up with it on their own. 341. Reaffirming our own faith in Jesus the Christ, we gladly welcome you into this community of faith, enfolding you with our love and committing ourselves to your care and the power of God's Spirit. Let us mutually encourage each other to trust God and strengthen one another to serve others, that Christ's church may in all things stand faithful. Welcome. I'm going to have you come out with me so everybody can greet you. So, and then are we ready to do, can we do one more round of that last song? The last,
let's do the first verse.
The first verse.